Everybody, we're gonna go this way.
Do you play soccer?
Yeah.
Hey, okay, this way. Dribble through the cones.
I'm retired
girls.
Now.
Go. Dribble through the cones.
Cool.
Let's go, Emma. Grab your ball. Let's go.
Les États-Unis, pour nous Français, c'est l'Eldorado du football. Ici, on parle de soccer et à l'origine, ils appartiennent aux femmes.
Allez, on s'échauffe un peu là. Réveille-toi un peu, Ginette.
Little Miss Soccer. Et ça, ça claque.
Nous sommes devenus fans de Miami et de toute l'équipe américaine lors de la Coupe du Monde 99. Une finale remportée à domicile devant plus de 90 000 spectateurs. La nation étoilée a tout gagné et n'est pas rassasiée. J'ai toujours rêvé de jouer ici, où les footballeuses sont reconnues et respectées. Ce rêve américain, finalement, je le vis par procuration, en suivant la capitaine des Bleus, Amandine Henry.
Ça m'a fait une drôle de sensation quand tu vois déjà tout le stade rempli, les fumigènes, vraiment un stade de garçons, à la limite une ambiance vraiment, une très belle ambiance et tout ça. Donc tu as vraiment envie de te battre rien que pour par respect par rapport au public, quoi, déjà. Comme le championnat il est assez compétitif, et ben, tu sais pas si tu peux perdre contre le dernier, tu peux gagner contre le premier. C'est un peu... ouais, c'est dur, mais en même temps, c'est ce qui fait le charme aussi de cette ligue.
La National Women's Soccer League, le championnat élite et professionnel. Toutes vivent de leur passion et pratiquent dans des conditions idéales. Un football physique à l'esprit combatif.
The stadium is full like that?
No, always. I think it holds 22,000 and usually 18,000. They sing a song for every player and it's like no other place in the world. It's a city that loves to empower females and they love women in sports and complete support of women who play. And, you see it.
These are amazing athletes, and these amazing athletes need support. So it's important for us, not just me, but for all of us, to make sure that they know they are professional athletes and we love them. We are for supporting our neighbors and our friends and our family. If you are gay, if you are transgender, if you're a male, if you're female, we're not going to just sit down and say this is sports. This is life, and you cannot get out of politics. You cannot. Saying that you're not political is privilege.
Paradoxalement, les internationales américaines, égérie mondiale et athlètes en puissance, restent encore moins bien payées que les hommes. Elles viennent d'assigner en justice la fédération afin d'exiger l'égalité salariale. Engagées sur les terrains comme dans la société, ces rôles modèles donnent des ailes aux jeunes filles. La popularité du soccer est incontestable. À Portland et ailleurs, nous les avons vues dès le plus jeune âge faire de chaque parc un terrain de jeu.
Je ne veux pas travailler, non, je ne veux pas travailler.
Quoi, c'est quoi Hollywood Soccer?
Hollywood.
Hood? Non.
Si, je te jure, c'est Hollywood.
Oh.
Là, le terrain de... des petites du club de Hollywood.
Mais c'est un terrain vague.
Bah, non, c'est leur terrain.
Hein? We're called a club, but we're a recreational club. Mm. Every kid typically starts there, like around age 5. From there, they'll go, you know, play a little bit more competitive. They definitely have club teams, but there are more competitive clubs, and you pay more money.
Direction, good job. Everybody's running around a circle. Maybe some people should run around in different directions.
I feel like with soccer, you have to use two parts of your mind because
you have to kick the soccer ball and have the soccer ball in vision, and also you have to be running. And for football, you just have to hold it, and it's kind of easier. But for soccer, you have to kick it, yeah. But also keep control of the ball.
Je ne perds un temps pour lui.
Pour embrasser ensuite une carrière, la Fédération américaine structure la pratique des meilleurs jeunes autour de la Development Academy. Ce programme réunit 65 clubs de tout le pays et organise des championnats régionalisés très compétitifs.
C'est un club qui gagne assez souvent. C'est fou ça.
Nous venons assister à l'entraînement de l'Eclipse Select Soccer Club dans la banlieue de Chicago. Plus de 600 joueuses y font leur classe.
Je sais pas lequel est ça, hein, évidemment. C'est la plouf à chaque fois, on fait des paris.
Plouf plouf, alors
bah, je pense que c'est celui qui est sur le terrain. Parce que c'est censé être le président entraîneur des U18, U19.
We played on Saturday, so Sunday was recovery day. Yesterday was the off day. Today we'll start to get back into it. Tomorrow's the higher intensity level, and then Friday will be game prep. The level for the DA and the ECL is high, so the games are very competitive, very physically demanding, tactically getting better, technically gradually getting better.
The goal is to prepare that girls to play for Chicago Red Stars.
yes, that is the goal. I think our goal is to, one, make sure the players have a positive experience with the sport. Two, try to help them develop and reach whatever their full potential is going to be.
3-2. Do it again.
Come on, guys.
The player don't earn money at 18, for example.
Earn money?
Yeah. No.
College scholarship.
Yeah, okay.
Figure on average a college scholarship is $50,000 a year. So if one of our players gets 50% for 4 years, they get $100,000 off their college. A lot of them use soccer to pay for universities.
Oh, okay.
Le haut niveau se paye. L'accès à ce type de club coûte entre 3 000 et 6 000 dollars par saison. La suite se passe à l'université, SAS de détection des futures joueuses pro. Le meilleur soccer à Chicago est celui des Red Stars, l'équipe phare de la ville, pensionnaire de la National Women's Soccer League.
On a un petit peu d'avance, on va patienter parce que quand même c'est un gros bonnet.
All the pro clubs have a different model. There are 3 that own MLS, men's soccer clubs at the first division, and also women's, and they have much more what you're describing. They have academies and youth clubs, more like where I think we've got to get to eventually. But then there are 7 more independent clubs, and that number will change. I think we'll get less and less independent because it's hard to keep up. But each of us can make, within some range, our own decisions.
If they even have one.
So when we sat and designed this league, we knew we had to take costs out because you can't count on the revenues for a while. And that's part of why the US Federation, the Canadian Federation, the Mexican Federation agreed to pay the salaries for their players to be in this league. That was the big change in NWSL.
She coaches all over, you know, different places in Chicago.
We live here.
You keep walking, you hit the zoo, you can go down through the zoo to get to Old Town.
Ah, okay.
Have you been to the zoo?
No.
Just keep
keep walking. Okay. You'll be in the zoo.
Oh, perfect.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye bye. Why? Il faut aller au zoo.
Pour la première fois en 2017, une chaîne de télévision a acheté les droits du championnat pour 3 ans.
Nous sommes à Lifetime, c'est la chaîne de télévision qui diffuse la NWSL, le championnat de soccer féminin. On a rendez-vous avec Evan, je tairai son nom parce que je... Silverman.
Parce que d'un coup j'ai eu...
parce que j'ai oublié.
Et là on est évidemment avec une tête connue. Amandine Henry, championne de National Women's Soccer League, saison 2017.
If we wanted to help grow the league and really be invested in it as a company, we needed to have an investment stake in the league itself and not just broadcast the games. We actually bought a stake in the league. We own 25% of the National Women's Soccer League. If we just were in this for 2 or 3 years and didn't have a long-term stake in it, it wouldn't make any sense. Mm-hmm. This is about 5 years, 10 years, 20 years down the road. Major League Soccer has been around 20 plus years here in the United States. The National Women's Soccer League has only been here 5 years. Obviously, women's sports are not as accepted in the United States or in the world as men's sports. We still have a long way to go as a country and as a society embracing women's sports. They still are not treated at the same level always as a lot of the men's sports are.
Faute d'audience, ce partenariat a pris fin cette saison après seulement quelques matchs. Preuve que le pays du soccer n'est pas qu'étoile.
Je sais pas, là j'ai pas l'accroche.
C'est quoi le moment du départ du bateau pour retrouver Manhattan et monter dans le Bronx?
On va aller à la rencontre des jeunes filles qui jouent au football avec l'association South Bronx United.
C'est assez simple comme architecture. C'est assez anodin, on voit ça partout.
Aux États-Unis, à l'inverse du reste du monde, nous constatons que la pratique du soccer de haut niveau appartient essentiellement aux riches et aux blancs. L'association South Bronx United questionne son accessibilité et l'organise pour les jeunes issus majoritairement de familles immigrées et défavorisées.
Elles préparent leurs séances, elles s'entraînent le mardi, le jeudi et elles ont les matchs le dimanche.
Since I was six, so...
Six?
So I guess I'm...
How old are you?
I'm 13, wait.
Bambo, Jennifer. Apurate, wait.
It's on Roo.
It's on Roo.
We're working on a documentary, right?
Exactly.
About women and girls soccer around the world. I just want to make sure you know that's who these strange people are.
It's not just about soccer, it's about creating better people, so it's about development on and off the field. So the girls that are in this program, they have to not only do soccer training, but they have to do academic tutoring as well for their classes. So Mondays and Wednesdays they're in the classroom, and Tuesday, Thursday they're out here training for soccer.
This area has the highest poverty rate in the whole country. The whole United States here, there's a 49% child poverty rate. A lot of them are coming from difficult situations, at home or their community. Some kids never played soccer before, but needed something to do during out-of-school time. There's a big lack of after-school programs. Some kids that loved soccer, a kid from Ivory Coast, Nigeria, Jamaica, Mexico.
When those type of, I guess, resources are kind of hard for you to attain, it is harder for you to navigate in the soccer world in America, especially as a woman.
1, 2, 3,
FBU!
Nous profitons du week-end pour accompagner Chelsea à son match.
It's more about having them grow as an individual and developing skills on the soccer field that's going to help them in their everyday life.
Ladies, get back into your positions!
So it's good for them to have that development and that self-worth, that self-confidence and being able to overcome that. And especially when you play a sport like soccer, which is male-dominated,
yeah.
now you can actually feel better about yourself that you can do anything. Mm. It's really, really important for these girls because now they hopefully will go out and find jobs as well that are outside the stereotype roles, and they're doing it because they love it and not just because they're told they have to do that kind because it's the way, you know, so they're thinking outside the box, they're getting outside the box.
Mm-hmm. ¿Puedes decirnos de dónde
son? ¿Cuál? Sí, tenemos niñas de México, de Colombia, de Ecuador.
Right. Where are you from?
Chile and Peru.
Oh, Chile y Perú.
Wow.
Chile, Peru. I feel like it's like okay, a like a door to many Andrea. Opportunities because they've given me so many opportunities.
Andrea, you have a person to sit with. Another assistant coach.
Like experiences that I would have not had if it weren't for South Bronx United. I think it's like it kind of put me on a different path, but like a better path.
Two, three, SBU!
Good stuff, ladies.
Gabby, awesome.